Well, good morning and welcome to Thomas Terrace Baptist Church. We're glad that you're here today. And I know it's been quite a week, but you know what? We're going to celebrate this morning anyway. That's what coming to church on Sunday morning is. We're celebrating what the Lord has done in our lives. Won't you stand and let's sing this song called Happy Day. Talk about that happy day when Jesus saved us and set us free. If you're not awake this morning, we hope you will be by the end of the song. Here we go. Great.
Jesus is alive. The empty cross, the empty grave. Life eternal, you have won the day. Shout it out, Jesus is alive. He's alive. And oh, happy day, happy day. You washed my sin away. Happy day, happy day, I'll never be the same. Forever I am changed.
When I stand,
and when I stand in that place, free at last, meeting face to face, I am yours. Jesus, you are mine. Endless joy, perfect peace. Earthly pain finally will cease. Celebrate, Jesus is alive.
Shout it out.
He's alive. And oh, happy day, you wash my sin away. Oh, happy day, I'll never be the same. Forever I am changed.
Oh, what a glorious day.
Oh, what a glorious day. What a glorious way that you. Forever I am changed. Forever I am changed.
Give the Lord praise this morning. They're laughing because they didn't think I had that yeah in me this morning. I didn't think I did either. But you know what? When Christ saves us, He calls us to follow Him. Wherever He goes, we go. Let's sing that this morning as a declaration.
Where you go, I'll go. Where you stay, I'll stay. When you move, I'll move. I will follow. All your ways are good. All your ways are sure. I will trust in you alone. Higher than my sight, high above my life. I will trust in you alone. In you alone. Where you go, I'll go. Where you stay, I'll stay. When you move, I'll move. I will follow you. Who you love, I'll love. How you serve, I'll serve. If this life I lose, I will follow you. Yeah, I will follow you. Yeah. Light unto the world, for you alone. You're the one I seek, knowing I will find all I need in you alone, in you alone. Where you go, I'll go. Where you stay, I'll stay. When you move, I'll move. I will follow you. Who you love, I'll love. How you serve, I'll serve. If this life I lose, I will follow you. Yeah, I will follow you. Yeah. In you there's life everlasting. In you there's freedom for my soul. In you there's joy, unending joy. And I will follow. Where you go, I'll go. Where you stay, I'll stay. When you move, I'll move. I will follow you. Who you love, I'll love. How you serve, I'll serve. Life I lose, I will follow. Where you go, I'll go. Where you stay, I'll stay. When you move, I'll move. I will follow you. Who you love, I'll love. How you serve, I'll serve. If this life I lose, I will follow you. Yeah, I will follow you. Yeah, I will follow you. Yeah, I will follow you.
Amen, church. That's what we're called to do. You may be seated.
Good morning, Thomas Terrace Church. So good to be in the house of the Lord at the end of the week or the beginning of the next, however you want to look at it. Just glad that this past week is behind us. Hopefully it calms down a little bit out there. We're so glad that you're here worshiping with us today at Thomas Terrace. If you do us a favor, if this is your first time visiting here at Thomas Terrace, in the pew back in front of you, there's a little compartment where your spare Bible is. There's also guest information cards in there. So pull out those guest information cards and fill one out and drop it in the offering plate as you're leaving today. Offering plates will be stationed by the exits, so there'll be a good-looking gentleman with a offering plate with a little felt in the bottom of it. Feel free to drop that card in the plate as you leave. Also, you can give your offering that way if you choose. If you choose to give physically, just drop it in. The usher will have the offering plate by the exit. Drop your offering in, and that'll be great. You can also give online, myttbc.com/give. Real simple way to give online, and I implore you to do that. Operation Christmas Child, we have 1 week left. For Operation Christmas Child collection for the boxes. If you have filled the shoe boxes, you can leave them at the Operation Christmas Child tables in the back of the sanctuary or in the children's area. If you haven't picked up a shoe box and still want to, you still have time. We still have shoe boxes available. So grab one on your way out, pick it up, fill it up, and bring it back next week. These boxes need to be returned by next Sunday because we will be praying over those shoe boxes during next Sunday's worship service. If you know any families struggling to put food on the table during this holiday season, pretty crazy and tough times for a lot of people in the community, we have access to food boxes to help those individuals out. So if you yourself and your family need a little hand up, or you know a family that does in the community, please contact the church office so we can help support them. Church leadership meeting is this Thursday at 6:30 right here in the sanctuary. This is for all ministry leaders and deacons. This meeting will again be right here at 6:30. All leaders within the church are expected to attend, so please make sure you mark your calendar for that. Next Sunday morning, we'll be recognizing and honoring all of our veterans. Our special guest speaker that day will be Dr. Stephen Keith. He's a really, really great speaker. He's the head of the Liberty University Chaplaincy Program. And E41, Liberty Bluegrass Band, will be at our be our special musical guest. So we're excited to have them here. So make plans to be here. Invite any local veterans. If you have neighbors or friends who are veterans, invite them to attend so that we can honor them. On November 22nd at 9:15, Pastor Grooms will be leading our Discovering Mission 401 class. This class is the final part of our Discovering Discipleship series, and this is for those who have completed the 101, 201, and 301 classes. Okay, in this class, students will begin to discover their mission and learn how to spread their unique stories and how to impact the world around them. So please contact the church office and sign up for that. Thanks, guys.
Thank you, Matt. Oh, coming my way today. That's right. You missed me that badly, huh? Well, you know, it's easy with everything going on in the news and such to forget where our hope is. But our hope is in the Lord Jesus Christ, and our hope is built there. So would you stand as we worship the Lord this morning? Let's sing a song along those same lines and reaffirm that Christ, He's our cornerstone. He's our firm foundation.
My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly trust in Jesus' name.
Let's sing that verse again. Reaffirm it this morning.
My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly trust in Jesus' name. Christ alone, cornerstone, weak made strong in the Savior's love. Through the storm, He is Lord, Lord of all. Darkness seems to hide His face. I rest on His unchanging grace. In every high and stormy gale, my anchor holds within the veil. My anchor holds within the veil. Christ alone, cornerstone, weak made strong in the Savior's love. Through the storm, He is Lord, Lord of all. trumpet sound. Oh, may I then in him be found, dressed in his righteousness alone, faultless stand before the throne. Christ alone, cornerstone, weak made strong in the Savior's love.
Aren't you thankful for that promise this morning, that he is Lord over all? Amen. You may be seated. I apologize. This holdover from the coronavirus, it messes with my throat and voice. So if I'm a little, you know, more like Bill Clinton this morning, I'm sorry. All right. That was a little too good right there, wasn't it? All right. We have a card. How do you segue from that? I have a card to read this morning. It says, with warmest thanks, grateful hearts, and deep appreciation for your thoughtfulness. Thanks for the pretty flowers and all your prayers. Love, Wyleen McGuire. And we've got several, many on our prayer list. And you see the names passing behind me. We want to highlight a few of these. And again, we remind you that when you come in every week, at both at this store and in the lobby, we have... Since we're not handing out a bulletin anymore, there is a sheet there that has Pastor's sermon outline. I really encourage you to pick that up. It will help you understand and remember what has been preached. But on the flip side is our prayer list, and we want to make sure that you pick those up. So make sure you stop by the table in the lobby after Sunday school or before service, or if you forgot this morning, pick it up on the way out so you can take it with you this week. You could rewatch the message and fill out the outline then. Twice is better than once. But we've got a few requests here we want to make you aware of. Continue to pray for Sue Reuter. She's recovering from knee replacement surgery from this past week. Also praying for the family of Roger Hudson, who was such a fixture over here, and he passed away this past Thursday. So be praying for that family and all the friends and such there. Also pray for the family of Jean Eckert, I think it is, this is Norma Vinoy's sister, and she passed away on Tuesday, and with everything they've had going on between with Dick and Norma's health and such, and for that to happen, it's just a lot. So be praying for Norma during this difficult time. Also be praying for Tanya Freese. She is recovering from cancer surgery that I think she had this past week, if I'm remembering. Took out half of her lung, okay? So very, very serious surgery, and so pray for her recovery. Also, be praying for Coach Smith. He does have bone cancer. They do think it is localized, from what I understand, and he will be beginning chemotherapy and radiation almost immediately. So be praying for that, and, you know, he was kind of waiting on the results and then to know he kind of knew the chemo and the radiation was what they were going to go with. It's just a matter of how much and how long and such. So be praying for Coach Smith and his family. And got a really cool thing planned this afternoon. A lot of the players and family and families and from the mathematics community are going to drive over because Coach Smith actually lives over in the New London area. I mean, like, he's way out there. They're going to drive over this afternoon, do a little parade out in his driveway to just encourage him. So be praying for him. Also be praying for Ray Showalter. This is Brian Showalter's dad. He's at home on hospice. Lori Pickerel has coronavirus, has COVID, so be praying for her, as does Anita Height. And so be praying for her, but also praying for Ronnie because he has his own health issues and in that situation. Also, Chris Grooms is facing, he's got back surgery coming up in just a few weeks, right before Thanksgiving. So Yikes. So be praying for Chris. I know this back issue has been causing him a lot of discomfort for some time. So we pray that this back surgery will fix that. Also, we got some requests over the weekend. David Doerr, this is Kim, who sings here quite often. Kim Doerr's husband had COVID, was kind of recovering from that, went in for kind of a final checkoff from the doctor. He could go back to work and found that he had viral pneumonia, blood clots in his lungs, very serious. And so it definitely needs your prayers. So be praying for David Doerr. And then be praying for Sarah Henderson. She's just experiencing some pain, and they thought was a gallbladder. It was not a gallbladder, and so she's just in a lot of pain. They can't figure out the source of that, and that's the worst, right? When you go to the doctor and they look at you and we can't tell you why you're hurting. And so be praying for Sarah as she's going through that. So let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father God, we just come to you today thanking you, Lord, that we could sing these truths that we sang this morning, Father, that you can be our Savior and save us from our sins, that you are a one we can follow and we can worship and we can serve, and Lord, the one we can trust who is our cornerstone. When everything around us is sinking sand, and there's a lot of sinking sand around and a lot of just uncertainty and anger and frustration, and it's just tearing at everybody right now. And Father, we place our trust in you. You're the one. You're the one in control. You're the one in control of the storms of our life, Father. And so we just trust you, and we pray through this circumstance and situation that our faith as individuals and our faith as a church would grow through this time. It's the times when we're pressed and we're pushed on, and when the hard times come, that's when our faith really grows. And so, Father, I just pray through this time that your will would be done. Your will would be done in our country. Your will would be done in our church. Your will would be done in each of our lives as individuals. For the many requests we prayed for those that are grieving the loss of loved ones, we ask for your peace in those situations. For the many that are some that are recovering from surgeries, Lord, we pray for that. For Lori and Anita that are battling COVID, Lord, I just pray for a quick healing and recovery from that. And for David Doerr, for these issues he's facing from his COVID situation, I pray for healing in his body. And for Sarah Henderson, that they would find the cause of this pain and be able to bring some relief. Now be with the continuation of our service. I pray that you would just fill Pastor with the words to say, open our hearts and our minds to what you would say to us, and that we would not that we would leave this place different than we walked in this morning. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
So God, God, we pray to you, humble ourselves again. Lord, would you heal our cry? Lord, would you heal our land? That every eye will see, that every heart would know, the one who took our sin, the one who died and rose. So God, we pray to you, humble ourselves again. Lord, would you hear our cry? Lord, will you heal our land? That every eye would see, that every heart would know, the one who took our sin, the one who died and rose. And when your kingdom comes, and when at last you call, we'll rise to worship you alone. Spirit of God, breathe on your church, pour out your presence, speak through your word. We pray in every nation, Christ be known, our hope and salvation, Christ alone.
Lord, we believe that you are merciful and you are mighty. We trust that you will guide and protect us during these tough and confusing times in our nation, O Lord. We know that we can trust you, so we cry out for you to protect us and guide us, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen.
Spirit of God, breathe on your church, pour out your presence, speak through your word. We pray in every nation, Christ be known, our hope and salvation, Christ alone.
A stranger, and you invited me in.
I was sick, and you looked after me.
I needed a teacher, and you inspired me.
I was lost, and you prayed for me.
I was addicted, and you helped me break free.
I needed a mentor, and you were there for me.
I felt alone, and you showed me true community.
You helped me experience the joy of worship.
You made me feel welcome and safe.
You gave me the strength to keep going.
You led me to Jesus.
I was telling Dick Manoy's class this morning I had to teach for him. At I went through two major surgeries, four major surgeries in the last couple of years, and And they were difficult times for me, I'll tell you, physically. And I struggled with regaining my health. But never at any time during that experience and those experiences did I ever get upset with God about it. I thought God was being kind of gracious to me for what I really deserve in life. But I'll have to admit that after Tuesday night, Wednesday, and Thursday night, I was very, very frustrated and a little upset with God. And so I had a conversation with God. We're supposed to talk to God as we've been preaching. And of course, God reminded me of my sermon last Sunday of when God says no and how we respond. And isn't that like God? God does that. Didn't speak to me audibly. I don't want you to get all scary and all that kind of stuff, but I knew it was God speaking, and he let me know in no uncertain terms. Remember what you preached last week. When I say no, then, you know, you just accept it, and I've got something else in mind. And I said, but I don't like it. And he said, that's not for you to determine. I've got it under control. But God, it's all unfair. That doesn't make any difference. I'm still in control. I'm still in charge, and they can't kick me off the throne. They can't vote me out of office. I'm here, and I'm here to stay. And your trust and your hope is in me, not in them. And he reminded me that we're not of this world. We're in the world, but we're not of the world. We can't control the things in the world around us. But you know what? He's still in control of the things around us. And so it has been a struggle, I will admit, for me, a real struggle. There's nothing I hate more than liars, and there's nothing I hate more than cheaters and those who steal. Those kind of things just really grate my nerves. Injustice, and I wonder where the Justice Department is. But you know, again, the Lord just let me know, this world is not your home. You're just passing through. This is the only corrupt world we'll ever know. When we get to heaven, we're going to enjoy peace, tranquility, and perfect justice all the time. In fact, the Bible tells us in Psalm 2 that he's going to rule with a rod of iron. You try cheating and lying and stealing in that kingdom, and guess what? You get zapped right then. There's no court of appeals. There's no Supreme. Well, there is a Supreme Court. And he is judge and jury and executioner all in one. He is God. And he's on the throne today. He will not be kicked off. Jesus said, I must work the works of him who sent me while it is day. The night is coming when no one can work. I was reminded this week again how brief our time is here on this earth. I'm going to be 66 years old in a few weeks, and I look back over my life and I think, phew, it's gone. It seems like yesterday that I just started in ministry as a 20-year-old kid preacher down in up in Winchester, Virginia. I was a youth director, and I was a youth major in college, but I wasn't a youth director in heart. Those kids tried to kill me. I had a big group. I mean, we had 80 kids just in our senior high class every Sunday. We had about 40 in our junior high class. I taught the senior high, and Eric Farrell taught the junior high, and together we had about 120 teenagers in that youth department. But I was not cut out for that work. They tried to kill me, and a few times I wish they had, because I wanted to kill them too. In fact, they claim I tried to kill one of them, and I didn't. I just picked him up and put him up against a trailer because he let the air out of the tires of my car with a trailer on the back of it and all my furniture in it. And he called me the other day. He apologized and thanked me for that. He's 60 years old now. But anyway, I was a young youth director when I first got started. But I look at that, and that just is like a blur. And all of a sudden now, it's 46 years later, and here I am, and it just seems like it's all behind me. And what's happening? Jesus said, work for the night comes when no man works. In other words, we only have a short span of time, and we have to occupy till he comes. We have a responsibility to serve when the opportunity is there, because if we lose and miss that opportunity, we lose and miss it forever. Jesus said, I must work the works of him who sent me while it is day, for the night is coming when no one can work. There's going to come a time when you can't do anything. It's too late. In the context of this verse, Jesus was passing through this particular village when he happened upon a blind man. Instead of continuing on his way, he was a busy man. The disciples told everybody he was too busy to take the little children. Remember that? And he rebuked the disciples and he said, allow the little children to come unto me, for if such is the kingdom of heaven. But instead of continuing on his way, he stopped and he took time to do ministry. He was never too busy to do ministry to people. And he performed a miracle on that man. You know what? You may never know the miracle that you're taking part in when you stop and take the time to do ministry, whether it's in Awana, whether it's in Sunday school, whether it's in the parking lot, whether it's in the video room, whether it's in the audio room, whether it's in the praise team or wherever. When you stop to take the time to do ministry, you never know what part of a miracle you just might be. And only heaven one day will reveal what that actually did for all eternity. No matter how seemingly insignificant what you do was done. The Son of God came to planet Earth, which he created on purpose and with a purpose. He said that his purpose was to do the will of his heavenly Father. I do not seek my own will. He wasn't looking out for his own interest. He wasn't looking out what was best for him. In fact, we talked about this a couple of weeks ago when he prayed, not my will, but thine be done. Your will, God, not what I want. He didn't want to take this cup. He said, if it'd be possible, let this cup pass from me. He said, no. I'm here to do the Father's will. And you know what? That's not ever easy. It's always difficult. It's going to require time. It's going to require sacrifice. It's going to require engaging yourself. In fact, Jesus only had a 3.5-year window of opportunity in which to accomplish his purpose on earth publicly, out of a total of 33.5 years of life. But those 3.5 years, think about this, changed the entire course of human history. Jesus was a difference maker. He was a change maker. He was a chain breaker. He was a way maker because he fulfilled his purpose. And when he accomplished his purpose, he cried out on the cross, "It is finished." The Apostle Paul said something very similar. The time of my departure is at hand. I've kept the faith. I've run my course. I've run it well. I stuck by the stuff. I finished strong. I see in this audience a conglomeration of ages. There are some of you young people over here and back here. And I see some of you young adults throughout this congregation. And I look around and I see some seasoned saints like myself around this audience. And you know what? We're not done until we breathe our last breath. And so the Bible says we are to work, for the night comes when no man works. We've got an opportunity still in America to preach freely, to witness freely. I know they try to suppress us and what have you, but you know what? They still can't. They still haven't completely stopped us. We better do it while we can, because there may come an opportunity, a common time here in this country where you cannot say, I believe in Jesus publicly. So you better take advantage while you can. Many years ago, I played tennis for fun and sport. I got Mac Arrington to go with me when I first moved here, and I thought I was going to teach him how to play tennis, and he really played me well. He didn't tell me that he already played tennis quite a bit. But in fact, he actually, I think he actually told me he hadn't played. So I was teaching him, you know, some of the ropes about playing tennis. But I noticed it wasn't very long before he's killing me on that court. And I thought, what in the world is this guy doing? And finally, I didn't find out until just recent years that he already knew how to play tennis, that he had played quite a bit, I think, with you guys. Virgie, didn't he play with you guys? And I think Dan Lee's parents, all those. He had played for years. He played me, but he was already in heaven before I found out about it, because I'd have really raked him over the coals for playing me like that. But I played tennis. I played it almost all my life. I never did get very good at it, because you got to work at something to get good at it, and I didn't like it enough to get that good at it. I just like to do it for sport and for competition. I always enjoyed competition, but I hate getting beat. But I learned that it takes a number of different skills to play that game effectively. You need to know how to use your forearm, your forehand, and the backhand in returning volleys very quickly. You also need to hone the ability to place the ball in your opponent's court as far away from them as possible to keep them on the run and cause them to miss returning the ball back to you. Dick Vannoy, at 80 years of age, would beat young bucks down at the YMCA just about every week. But Dick never moved more than three steps the whole entire time he played. He knew how to place that ball to make you hit it right back to him, and he'd just do this, and like to kill you. And everybody else is out there running the court, liking to kill themselves because they didn't know what to do. Dick honed the skills. He learned how to play the game effectively. He didn't tell him he'd been playing that game for 65 years. But all of these skills are necessary to be competitive in the match. However, there is one skill that is absolutely essential above all the rest, and that is having a superb serve. Serving the ball against your opponent effectively and with power can make all the difference in the outcome of the match. So the serious tennis player will spend a great deal of time practicing on improving their serve. And that's what I want to talk to you today about, and what I want to talk to us about as Christians in the spiritual realm, on improving our serve. That's the purpose of our lives in Jesus Christ, is service. And we are to be like Him in fulfilling God's purpose. And how did Jesus do that? He said, for even the Son of Man did not come to be what? He didn't come to be served, but to what? He came to serve. We're never more like Jesus than when we're serving. But to serve and to give His life a ransom for many. Now, what did He mean by that? In His humanity, He submitted Himself as a servant who serves. The Lord Jesus Christ, when confronted by His arch enemy and opponent, the devil, about worshiping and serving, He made this statement, which also applies to every single child of God today. Jesus said to him, "Away with you, Satan, for it is written, you shall worship the Lord your God, and Him only shall you shall serve." Him only. That's who we serve. So I'm going to talk to you today about your service to God, and what God expects. In the book of Romans chapter 12 and verse 1, the Apostle Paul makes a clear argument for our service and why we should serve. He said, "So brothers and sisters, since God has shown us great mercy, I beg you to offer your lives as a living sacrifice to Him. Your offering must be only for God and pleasing to Him, which is the spiritual way for you to worship." Isn't that interesting? Worship and service always go together. "Do not change yourselves to be like the people of this world, but be changed within by a new way of thinking. Then you'll be able to decide what God wants for you. You will know what is good and pleasing to Him and what is perfect." Paul is begging us here, because of the great mercies of God, which are new every morning, thank God for that, and includes the fact that God sacrificed His only begotten Son to pay a sin debt that He didn't owe for a debt we do owe and cannot pay. And in paying that debt for us, he made us children of God. Look at it in Romans chapter 8. He says, the Spirit himself bears witness with our spirit that we are children of God. And if children, then heirs, heirs of God, and joint heirs with Jesus Christ. Whatever Christ has belongs to us. Read Ephesians chapters 1 through 3 and see your tremendous blessings you already have in Christ Jesus. Your riches you already have in Christ Jesus. Man, he's made us a millionaire in eternal things. Joint heirs with Christ, if indeed we suffer with him, that we also may be glorified together. For I consider that the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory which shall be revealed in us. We're children of God. He's made us his children. My friends, that's mercy and grace. We not only don't get what we deserve, hell, but we get what we do not deserve, which is, I got this backwards here. We don't get what we deserve, and that's hell, but we get what we don't deserve in grace and mercy. We don't have God's condemnation on us. The condemnation has been removed, Romans 8:1. There is therefore now no condemnation to them, Christ Jesus. I love that verse, one of my favorite verses. Every time I get to feeling a little bit puny, and every time I get to thinking, you know, you just keep messing up. You just keep messing up no matter, and the devil loves to get on your shoulder and tell you that. And you know what I quote him? There is therefore now no condemnation to them who are in Christ Jesus. And guess how you got in Christ Jesus? You trusted him as your Lord and your Savior. You invited him into your life, and he transformed you from the inside out. He is God of glory within you. You are one with him. Hallelujah. And so you know there is therefore now no condemnation because I'm in Christ. You need to ask yourself that question. Am I in Christ? Do I really know him? Do I know that I know that I know him? You know, the only thing that causes doubt in your life is when you're not walking with him. You know why? Because 1 John 5:13 says, these things have I written to you that believe on the name of the Son of God, that you may know that you have eternal life. You know it when you're walking in the Word. These things have I written. What did he, what was written? The Word of God, the Bible. You need to be in your Bible every day. The confidence that you'll get to live your Christian life, the confidence that you'll have that you're in the right relationship for eternity is through the reading of the Word of God. I challenge this church every year on the first Sunday of the year, read through the Bible this year. Every Christian ought to be constantly reading through the Bible. You say, well, I read it through once. Well, that's not enough. That's like saying, I ate breakfast 3 weeks ago, but that's okay. I'll be fine for the rest of the year. You think so? Now, we'll be visiting you in the psych ward at the hospital and with a needle in you, pumping food into you because you didn't eat. And the same thing is happening spiritually to God's people all over the United States of America. They're weak and they're anemic. They don't know what God wants for their life. They're just meandering around, just taking up time and space. And Jesus said, I didn't save you for that junk. Because of the mercies of God, you need to get up and get. You need to get out and serve. You need to be engaged. You need to be involved. That's what he's talking about. In fact, that's how you grow. But you grow when you read the book and then you start applying the book by getting engaged and getting involved. So on the basis of God's mercies alone, we should consider our Christian life as a living sacrifice of service to God as our highest number one priority. So if we're going to improve our serve, we need to know about our aptitude for service. Now there are four passages, or really three passages of Scripture in the New Testament that spell out the descriptions of our aptitude for serving the Lord Jesus Christ. Now time today will only permit us to look at just one of those passages in Romans chapter 12. Remember the text we just read earlier where Jesus talked about the worship with the devil? It's interesting there because he connected service with worship. Worship with service. Are you aware that when you are in the service of the Lord, you're actually worshiping God? Even changing a diaper in the church nursery is an act of worship. And we need to do this till the day we die or totally incapacitated and can't. Jesus says, you shall worship the Lord your God, and him only shall you. What does he say? Serve. That's worship. Worship and service are inseparable. You can't do the one without the other. It's impossible. Serving others in the church and outside the church is an act of worship to God. Now let's look at chapter 12 of the book of Romans, beginning at verse 3, to discover what our aptitude for service really is. Look at what he says here. For I say, through the grace given to me, to everyone who is among you, not to think of himself more highly than he ought to think, but to think soberly. In other words, you need to have a good self-introspection. You need to think the way you ought to think. You shouldn't look down on yourself. And by the way, that's a form of pride, saying, I can't do anything. I'm so dumb. I'm so inept. I'm so incapable. I can't do anything. That's pride. That's, you're just saying that to get out of work. You don't want to serve. And the Bible says everybody can serve, and you need to be serving. You need to figure out what your aptitude for that service is and then plug into it and actively pursue it to the rest of your life and for the rest of your life. Somebody asked me one time if I was going to retire. I said, well, when God calling leaves me, then I will quit. Until then, I'll keep going until you guys say he's too old, he's too demented, and he's not able to get up here and make a complete sentence like some people I've heard recently who ran for high office, couldn't put two words together in a sentence that made any sense. Now, when I get to that point, then, you know, at that point, you're going to have to put me out to pasture. But until then, I'm supposed to serve. Somebody asked Chuck Swindoll the other day when he was going to retire. He's 80 years old. He's still pastoring a church in Plano, Texas. They asked him, said, when are you going to retire? And he said, when I can't do it anymore. W.A. Criswell was in his 80s, pushing 90 when he finally retired. First Baptist Church of Dallas, Texas, for 100-year span, had only two pastors. Two pastors who served 50 years each, back to back. That's quite a span, isn't it? Now, God doesn't call us and then tell us that, you know, at age 65, you have to quit. That's why at 65 and nearly 66, I'm still here. And thank God you're still coming. You keep coming and I'll keep doing it. He says, you're not to think of yourself more highly than you ought to think. In other words, you're not to be conceited and think, oh, I'm so blessed and I'm so talented. I'm going to tell you about that in just a minute. But you're to think soberly. In other words, have a good self introspection. Know yourself. Know what you're able to do. And do it, and do it well. Paul said, do it heartily as unto the Lord. As God, and notice this phrase, should be underlined up there. As God has dealt to each one a measure of faith. In other words, each believer has an aptitude for Christian service. As God has dealt to each one this measure of faith. Because our Christian service is tied with our comprehension of our spiritual ability given to us by God to serve. So he proceeds then to talk about the church collectively. He says, for as we have many members in one body, but all members do not have the same function, so we, being many, are one body in Christ and individually members of one another. Every one of us are a part of this body, the local body. Yeah, there's the invisible church, but we are the local body of believers, and we represent what the church is worldwide. And you can't just belong to the invisible church without being engaged in the local church. Well, the local church got so many problems. And you know why? Because got people in it. And you know why? Because people are flawed. People are sinful. And all of these issues. Let me tell you something. There's no perfect place. We don't live in a perfect country. You don't live in a perfect society. That society won't come until Jesus Christ comes to reign on planet Earth. But until then, guess what? You're stuck. And we're stuck with each other. So you know what? We need to learn how to follow the scriptures in engaging with one another and learning our aptitude for service and start plugging into it and doing it with all of our heart, with all of our soul, and with all of our might. That's how you worship. Don't tell me you're worshiping God and you don't do a blessed thing to serve the Lord your God. It's impossible. The church is the body of Christ. And each individual in the church is a vital part, a vital organ. You, every one of you, teenagers. I pastored my first church in Gardena, California. I was 21 years old. We had a fairly large bus ministry there. We had 5 buses. Those people would bring in 60 kids. You could just see them hanging out the windows. The California Highway Patrol, and you know how persnickety they are out there. I mean, they were tough then. They'd come and red tag my buses every week, tell me I couldn't run them. We'd go and we'd get them fixed, slap them together. I mean, super glue. They didn't have Gorilla Glue back then, but if they'd have had it, that's one of those buses would have been held together. But they did have duct tape. We used a lot of duct tape. And those buses went out every week bringing in all these boys and girls, about 250 every Sunday. We averaged about 50 kids per bus every Sunday out there. You know who ran that? Teenagers. The youth. I mean, we're talking about kids 15, 16 years old. Some of them weren't even old enough to drive yet, so I had to find drivers to take them out on their visitation routes, and they'd go out and visit all day on Saturday, and they'd bring all those boys and girls in, and tons of those kids got saved. Their lives eternally changed. I still get notes and letters from these people. Now, they're all, a bunch of them are in their 60s now, but these teenagers, and God used those teenagers in a powerful way. That church is still going strong for the Lord Jesus Christ. Why? Because teenagers got involved. You're not too young. In fact, I was coming in the back way back here a while ago after I got mic'd up, and I looked over, and I didn't see Fallon and Finley in there, and I asked where Fallon was. Because she's in the middle school now, so she goes to middle school activities and middle school classes and what have you. So I asked her, I said, where's Fallon? They said, she's in junior church. And I learned that the reason they asked her to be in junior church is because she can handle the little kids. The ones that are kind of rowdy, she's got an understanding of those. I don't know why, but she has a real clear understanding of helping those kids to sit and to listen. She holds them on her lap. Hey, she's 11 years old, just turned 11 in September. Ladies and gentlemen, you need to get involved. You need to get engaged. You're a part, connecting to each other. That makes the church function in a healthy manner. Then it continues on, having then gifts differing according to the grace that is given to us. In other words, we got grace at salvation, but this is a grace to serve. You say, well, okay, yes, you can. He's given you grace to serve. Just like he's given you grace to be saved, he's given you grace to get engaged. He said, look at this phrase, let us use them. Those grace. We all have a spiritual aptitude for service. We're to put it to work for God. Then he elaborates on what these spiritual abilities are and how they function. He said, if prophecy, let us prophesy in proportion to our faith. Prophecy is that ability to preach or proclaim the word of God by the power of God, or ministry. And by the way, this is another word for serving. These Christians like to work behind the scenes for the most part, doing the little things that make the difference in the tone and tenor of the church. He said, let us use it in our ministry. He who teaches in teaching. If you have the ability to teach, guess what? You need to be teaching. You need to find a Sunday school class. You need to go see Cheryl Ellis or Chris Ellis or Matt Klein or some of these who are engaged. You need to begin teaching a class. He who exhorts in exhortation. And those with this aptitude are so important to the church. Because everyone needs encouragement. They need exhortation. This is the gift that we primarily look for in deacons, because they are exhorters. They engage with people and try to pick them up and lift them up and encourage them and minister to them. He who gives with liberality. Did you know that giving is a part of a spiritual gift? Now, every believer has the ability to give generously, but There are those who have been blessed with wealth through wise financial management or an inheritance, and they have the ability to give large sums of money to advance the gospel ministry, and they need to do so. That's their ministry. They have the ability to make it so that they can give it to make ministries continue on. He who leads with diligence. There are those who serve behind the scenes, and then there are those who serve out front. They are charged with leading. They have an aptitude for rallying people and organizing them to accomplish together what one could never do alone. In fact, your body, just in case you don't know this, your body has a head. Did you know that? Surprise to some of you. And inside that head, some of you actually have a brain. No, you all have a brain. Everybody has a brain. And guess what that brain does? That brain tells the rest of the body what to do. Did you know that? It sends impulses to your hand. It sends it to my hand right now. Move. Do this. Waving your hands helps to you communicate. I don't know. I talk with my hands. Your brain tells your body what. Your brain's what gets you up. Your brain's what gets you moving. Your brain is what tells you to bend over when you need to bend over. I mean, your brain controls everything. It's the head. And guess what? If the brain dies, so does the body. The church always need leaders that will serve. He says diligently or conscientiously. You conscientiously do diligence in your area of leadership within the church. You need to be finding other people. That's what leaders do. They lead leaders. They learn to find other people and engage them, delegating responsibilities so that everybody gets involved. And then, last but not least, he who shows mercy with cheerfulness. We get our English word hilarity from this Greek word translated cheerfulness. In other words, those with this aptitude have the ability to embrace offenders with a positive and affirming approach in a kind and loving manner to bring about restoration. Now, Jesus Christ, in his earthly ministry, he embodied and exercised all these spiritual gifts and aptitudes. Though some of you are multi-talented, multi-gifted, most of us are not. I can only do about one thing well. I found out yesterday when our faucet in our sink in the kitchen started leaking, and I tried to fix it. You know, most plumbers probably take them about 20 minutes to fix that. I worked on it all afternoon and all into the evening, and it's still not fixed. I've got to work on it some more because that's not my gift or my talent. But I'm too cheap to hire a plumber. So if some of you are plumbers and want to come over and fix it, you're welcome. But I want to remind you, those of you who are multi-talented, of what Jesus said. He said, for everyone to whom much is given from him, much will be required. And to whom much has been committed of him, they will ask the more. You know what we found out through the years of ministry? Is this, that if you want to find somebody to do a job that you need to have well done, find somebody usually that's already doing it. Already doing something, already engaged. Poor Sam and Judy, they've been doing everything from A to Z around here for 32 years. You know why we always prevail upon them? Because we know they'll do it. You don't get any back talk. You don't get any excuses. They just, okay, we'll find a way to make it happen. And make it happen. You go ask somebody that's not doing anything. You think, we ought to get these people involved because they're not doing anything. You know what we found out? They're not doing anything because they don't want to do anything and don't ever plan to do anything. I just want to say to you that are like that, shame on you. Because one day you're going to stand before God and give an account of why you didn't do what you were talented and gifted to do. If you're saved, you got a gift, and you better start using it because you're going to stand before Jesus Christ one day and answer to him for why you didn't. You say, well, I thought there was no condemnation. No, you're not going to be condemned. You're just going to have to answer why you didn't use your gift. That's what he said right here. Much is going to be required. In other words, the greater your aptitude, talents, skills, and abilities, the more God's going to expect from you and judge you by at the judgment seat of Christ. Now, as we discover our God-given ability for service, number two, we need to keep in check our attitudes toward service. We should have the attitude toward our ministry, our service in the church that Jesus described over in Luke 17. He said, "And which of you, having a servant plowing or tending sheep, will say to him when he has come in from the field, 'Come at once and sit down to eat'? But will he not rather say to him, 'Prepare something for my supper, and gird yourself and serve me till I have eaten and drunk, and afterward you will eat and drink'?" Does he think that servant because he did the things that were commanded him? I think not. I don't think so. So likewise you, when you've done all those things which you are commanded, say, "We are unprofitable servants. We have done what was our duty to do." We're unprofitable. That's the attitude that Jesus wants us to have in service. We're to do it because we're doing it for him. You're not doing it for me. You're not doing it for Thomas Terrace Church. You're doing it for him. And when you're doing it for him, it sure makes it a whole lot easier. Because you know what? I'll disappoint you. I've probably already done that a million times over the last 32 years here. But I'll guarantee you, he will never disappoint you. Even when we don't understand what he's doing, he's still not disappointing us. We just have a skewed view of what he's doing. That's all. That's our only problem with it. He always does all things well. You know, in my almost 66 years of life and 46 years in full-time vocational gospel ministry, this attitude of service that I just talked about is a very rare find. But we've enjoyed a number of people here at Thomas Terrace Church with this humble spirit. I can't begin to tell you what a delight it is to pastor a group like this. They follow that challenge that John F. Kennedy made in his inaugural speech. Ask not what your country can do for you, but ask what you can do for your country. You need to have that attitude. Ask not what your church can do for you, but what you can do for your church, what you can do for the Lord. Ask not what the Lord can do for you, but what you can do in his service as a child of God, as a born-again child of God. He's already done everything for you and loaded you with riches beyond this world's imaginations. True Christian service is saturated in an attitude of humility. Look at what Jesus said, "For the kingdom of God is not a matter of what we eat or drink, but of living a life of goodness and peace and joy in the Holy Spirit." If you serve Christ with this attitude, look at what Paul wrote, "You will please God and others will approve of you too." Number three, we need to employ positive actions in service. You know, it's one thing to talk about what you're going to do, but quite another to actually do it. God's call for service is God's call to action. We are all familiar with the parable of the talents, where God gave three individuals three different amounts of money and he told them to invest it wisely. When God gives anything, gifts, talents, skills, aptitude, money, he expects a return on his investment in you and me. Jesus explains it in that parable in Matthew 25, beginning at verse 16. "Then he who had received the five talents went and traded with them and made another five talents. And likewise, he who had received two gained two more also. But he who had received one went and dug in the ground and hid his Lord's talent." "I'm not good enough. I can't do this. I can't do that. I don't have that talent. I don't have that skill." But you have something. And many people just throw it into the ground and hide it and never use it. Look at what the Lord says. "After a long time, the Lord of those servants came and settled accounts with them." I want you to notice what Jesus said about that last guy who went and hid it, who did nothing with his talent, but his Lord answered and said to him, "You wicked and lazy servant. You knew that I reap where I've not sown and gather where I've not scattered seed. Therefore, take the talent from him and give it to him who has the 10 talents. Wow. You want to sit on your blessed assurance and do nothing for Jesus Christ? That's what Jesus has to say about you. You're wicked. You have the ability and you're doing nothing. Your spiritual gift is God's call on your life to active full-time Christian service. I'm not talking about full-time vocational ministry. I'm talking about your Christian life. It's full-time, 24/7. Whether you're at work, no matter where you are, whatever your hand finds to do it, you do it heartily, as unto who? The Lord. It's not for yourself. Even at work, if you got a bad boss and he's a bully and he does mean things to you, you serve with all your heart, your mind, and your soul because you're serving the Lord God. I'm talking about real ministry. When you were born again into the family of God, Jesus immediately through the Holy Spirit gave you a spiritual gift for service, and he expects you to use it for service. Ephesians says, but to each one of us, grace was given according to the measure of Christ's gift. Therefore, he says, when he ascended on high, he led captivity captive, and he gave gifts to men. You got one. What are you going to do with it? You say, well, I don't know. I don't know what mine is. Come to our 301 class, and we'll show you how to discover it. We'll be doing that here in the near future. You need to find out. If you want to find out now, we'll give you a spiritual gifts inventory test to give us an idea what direction you might want to be looking into, to find out where you're gifted and gifted and talented and skilled in. There are many areas that need service around here. We need Sunday school teachers. We need workers. We need people that will plunge in head first and get engaged and get involved. Our youth ministry, it's exciting. I come over there on Sunday nights. You got a buku of kids down there on Sunday nights now. And guess what? There's a whole bunch of workers down there too. And they're having more fun than the kids, I think. But you need to get involved. You need to get engaged. Choir will be starting back up sometime after first year, Lord willing. And guess what? We need to fill this whole thing up. I think you got about 50 seats up here. We need 50 people in the choir. That'd take about half of you people in here this morning. We have a multitude of ministries that need workers, leaders, and just warm bodies. You need to get involved. You know, one of our mottos and goals is every member a minister, because that's what God called us to do, is to minister. Now, if you do not have a spiritual gift for Christian service, it could be very well that you do not know or have the giver in your heart and in your life. You're really not a child of God. But I guarantee you this, he wants you to be in his family. In fact, he went to the cross of Calvary to make you a part of his family if you will come to him just as you are without one plea. He's made becoming a part of his family just as simple as ABC. A, you must admit that you're a sinner and you can't save yourself. You must be willing to repent of your sins and turn from your sins, turn from your wicked ways, turn to him by faith, and believe that Jesus, that's the B, believe that Jesus is God come in the flesh, died on the cross for your sins, was buried, rose again literally, bodily, physically from the dead, and is alive forevermore. You got to believe that. Believe in Jesus and then see. Not only believe, you've got to be willing to commit your heart and your life to him. You need to call upon the name of the Lord. For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. You willing to do that today if you haven't already? If you say, well, I don't have a talent, a skill, a gift for spiritual service, then it's probably because you don't have the giver inside of you. Because he led captivity captive and he gave gifts to men. He gave you one if you belong to him. So today, if you don't know him, would you call upon his name right there at your seat, right there on your couch if you're watching by way online? Would you pray this prayer with me right now? Pray, dear God, I admit that I am a sinner and I cannot save myself. I know that I have sinned against you and you alone. I am sorry for my sins, and I ask you to forgive me of my sins. I invite you into my heart, Lord Jesus, because I believe Jesus is God. I believe Jesus died for my sins. I believe Jesus rose from the dead and is alive forevermore. And so today, by faith, I call upon the name of the Lord. Invite Jesus Christ into my life right now, confessing my sins, confessing Jesus Christ is Lord. Come in today, Lord Jesus, I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. If you prayed that prayer, I need to know about it. We have a decision card in the pew in front of you. Take that out and fill that out and drop it in the offering plate, because I want to get you a Bible, a New Testament, and as well as a How to Begin Your New Life booklet that you can get to help you learn about your newfound faith in Jesus Christ and what it means to be saved, what it means to be a Christian. And then the next step of following the Lord in believers' baptism. Many of you haven't taken that step yet. You've never followed the Lord in believers' baptism. You need to be baptized. You need to mark that on a card. I need to get baptized. And you need to get baptized when we baptize this next time, and it'll be real soon. We want to invite you to do that. Also, those of you who are here today, you heard this message. What are you going to do with it? Sitting sour and soaking means nothing. You need to get engaged, get involved. There are areas of service, helping the poor, feeding the poor, helping one another here, getting involved in ministry. We need nursery workers. We need help. We need nursery workers. You heard a baby crying in here. A baby shouldn't be in here, and the family shouldn't have to be the ones every Sunday to take them into the nursery. We should have regularly scheduled nursery workers. Let me tell you, God will bless you for it. You can still hear what goes on in here. You just have to turn it up a little bit louder in there. But you can hear. You can get involved. Would you serve? Will you be a part, an active part of the body? You know what happens to parts of the body that just die on the vine? They cut it off because it's no use. Jesus talked about that in John 15. Get involved. Find a place to serve. Discover your spiritual gift, your spiritual ability for service, and plug in. We can do that. Let's stand together. I want to remind you tonight, prayer fellowship, meeting in the lobby classroom. And then, of course, I want to remind you of FOS tonight at 6 o'clock. Is that right? Pizza party. A pizza party tonight. Oh, well, I might just stop in again this Sunday night. Pizza. And we've got Bible studies are started back up again. Tracy, yours is going. Ours is at 6:30 every Wednesday night at my house. And any and everybody's welcome, up to 15 people, and we already have about 11. So four more are welcome to come if you want to come. Bible Institute is still going strong, and if you've got more interest in that, and by the way, you can discover more about your spiritual gifts, you get in that. So I want to encourage you to do that today. Okay, who's closing in prayer today? James, okay. James, I was wondering why you were sitting on the front row. God bless you, brother. This is one of our deacons. Pray for him. He's got a lot of health issues, but he's still serving. And you pray for him as he continues to serve. Would you close us in prayer, brother?
Our Father in heaven, Lord God, we thank you for this opportunity to come together in your name. We thank you for the guidance you give us. And we do pray, Lord, that you would help each of us to be faithful servants to you, honor you in all things, and we ask also, Lord, for your guidance through these troubling times. We thank you and praise you in Jesus' precious name. Amen.